Welcome at Erasmus University, welcome at the Rotterdam School of Management, welcome at the first general introduction session on the English taught bachelor program in International Business Administration. My name is Adrie Meidam. I work as director of the bachelor programs of Rotterdam School of Management. I guess the large majority of our audience is Dutch. You come from the neighborhood or probably more faraway places in the Netherlands. But as we're running an international program, I'm always curious, do we have any visitors from abroad who traveled in? That's nice. Thank you for making the effort. It actually is right to the heart of the program. We are running an international program and we see a lot of international students in this program as well, mixing with the Dutchies. So what are we doing today? A little bit of explanation, what you might study with us. So what is business? Why would you choose this program at this school? I mean, you could choose so many. A bit on the content of the program. Very important, admission, application. You might get enthusiastic, but you might ask yourself, how do I get in? And some practical things and questions if we have time left. However, with regard to the questions, we have also a session with four current students in the IPA program. They're well prepared and they're able to answer all your questions in the student session that is next to this presentation. So when we're talking business, what are we talking about? Actually, if you take a look at companies, you may soon find out that they all do the same in a certain way. There's always a finance department because you need to make a profit when you run a company. There's always the bookkeeping department, accounting, because you need to keep pay of your costs. There's always the marketing department because you want to promote the services and goods that you produce. There's sales, who actually get rid of the stuff, so to say. There's also purchases. You need to work with resources, with people, with third input. Actually, we commonly refer to these areas, functional areas in business. And regardless what company you take a look at, they will all do these kind of things. And this also reflects in business programs. So we teach you a little bit of accounting, a little bit of finance, a little bit of marketing, a little bit of supply chain, etc. These functional areas in business, they're common for many business programs taught all over the world. Actually, we also say you might become a specialist in a certain way, because as a broad program in the bachelor, we offer you the option to specialize in our master program, so you can choose to specialize in a finance master or marketing master. That's a highly specialized one. And it's also pretty likely that your first job, your career, will be in one of these areas. So you start somewhere as a banketeer, or in banking, in the investment sector, or running the personal department, human resources. So these areas, they matter. And when we take a closer look at the program, you'll see them popping up at various places. Still, it's impossible to properly run a company if you're only a specialist in one field. At least not if you want to be in charge. And maybe some of you already have in mind, I would like to become a CFO or even a CEO of an international company. I would like to be in charge. Then it's important that you're able to balance all the various interests, because of course the people buying doing the purchases, the goods, the input for the production will go for top quality, but this comes at a price. And the marketing department will say, we need another million to make a very professional promotion campaign. Still, your profits might be under pressure. In the end, someone being in business needs to operate strategically and should be able to keep the balance, to see the trade-off between all these areas in business. Only then a company can survive in the competitive world of nowadays. Actually, what we also do, it's very well possible that, let's say in 10 years' time, you find yourself somewhere on a project in, let's say, the United Arab Emirates, and you're supposed to work on a project that needs to be delivered on time, a business project. You're in a different country, different climate, different food, different habits, and you need to work with the Chinese, with the Germans, with the Bulgarians, all together in a project. Which can be a challenge, because of course we'll teach you the latest in business, but at the same time it's also very important that you will be able to successfully operate in an international environment. It makes a difference, for instance, in receiving and giving feedback, like in class, also in reality, when you work on a project, you may find a German colleague and you might not be satisfied with the work he delivered and tell him, that's not good. And maybe you answer, okay, I'll do it over and improve. However, if you would deliver this message in the same way to your Chinese colleague, you create damage and it will be very difficult to restore good working relations for the future. This sensitivity is one of the many dimensions of what we call intercultural competence, and this is something we do in the program. We have composed a program in such a way that the content is business on the one hand, but international on the other hand, and we make you work together with people from different backgrounds. We make sure that we have a mix in the house of Dutch students and international students to learn from each other. So, as I said, these functional areas, I already gave a little bit of explanation. You see, for instance, in finance, strategy, the markets, the customers, economic climate, there's happening so much in this world. And you can see, you could really go in-depth even within one of these functional areas. For instance, the one gaining importance nowadays is business information, business analytics. It's almost impossible to successfully run a company without being very well informed of what is happening in the tech, the IT, and the digital business area. It's vital if you want to survive as a company. Same for marketing. A lot of marketing is currently data-based. It requires a lot of data analytics. So you need to be aware of how to collect your information, which is an enormous amount of information. There's a lot of knowledge in this. Operations, same story. It's all very advanced. And at the same time, you're working with people. It's not that easy to run a company. And it's not that easy to manage people because they're individuals with their own mindsets, their own background, etc. That's also a challenge. It's very important to learn how a company can be successful. And for instance, this explains the area of organizational behavior. How exactly do people work and operate and behave in companies? So that's important stuff in the business. Then you might ask yourself, well, there's thousands of business schools all over the world. Why would I choose Rotterdam School of Management at Erasmus University? Why would I choose IBA here at this school? Well, a few reasons. If you're not Dutch, for instance, for today when you came from abroad, you may ask yourself, why would I choose the Netherlands to send my kid or for my studies myself? A few reasons. Dutch higher education is of high quality overall. And when you would take a look at the international rankings, for instance, the QS, Financial Times, the News World, etc., Times Higher Education, you will find the Dutch universities all within the first top 200 spots. So there's an indication of general average quality of the Netherlands being very high. Another indicator is also if external agencies say, ah, you're a good school. And one of the ways of doing so is accreditations. There are a few that really matter. For instance, the American one, ASCSB, well, we have that. The European one, EQUIS, we have that. The British one, AMBA, we have that. So we are a triple accredited school, which means there's a seal of quality. And there's only a smaller group of business schools who have this accreditation. There's also the rankings, these overviews, already mentioned. There's many of them. We think the Financial Times is a very important one. It's a bit of a lead because you can only be ranked by the Financial Times if you are internationally accredited. It takes into account many components, and normally we make it to a top 10 position. So we're in the rankings, regardless how they measure. Third indicator, what kind of schools are you cooperating with? Is it mediocre? Is it good? Is it top? Well, maybe you get a chance to take a look at a list of partner schools. It's in the brochure. You may also see it in the virtual information sessions. I think we have a top quality network. So that's a couple of indicators. Are you accredited? Are you ranked? And do you have a good partner network? Of course, we are academy, we are university, we are a research university, so we teach you the latest in business. At the same time, we also want to prepare you for the labor market. So there's pretty some hands-on components in the program as well. Business is changing over the years. We're past the era in which increasing turnover and increasing profits was the main important factor to run a business. It's still important because in the end you want to survive as a company, but there's also a lot happening in society. We know there's pressure on climate, on the environment, there's social injustice, there's a lot of things surrounding us in company, in the society. And actually, modern business schools cannot afford to not take a critical look at that and be able to bring some positive contributions to society. For this reason, as a business school, we have embraced a new mission, which says that RSM wants to be a force for positive change in the world. So we will teach you the latest in business, but at the same, we will also kind of deliver you to the labor market, to society, with a message. And the message is, well, we're able to have an impact. In the end, you will have a responsible job. You will be able to have impact on what happens in your company, in your environment, in society. And this, we expect you to play a role in this as well. It's very important nowadays. As said, we are international. Our pride is that we are able to successfully recruit large numbers of students from all over the world. So, for instance, this year we started with a class comprising no fewer than 50 different nationalities. There's very few programs in the world who can boast that. And, of course, there's some dominant nationalities, so to say. So the Dutch are the single largest group. They're around one-third of the intake. So they're the biggest group, but they're not the majority, because 66% of our intake is non-Dutch, comes from abroad. With some larger numbers from Germany, France, Italy, Spain, and some smaller numbers from Belgium, Indonesia, China, a lot of other countries. So it's really the world in your class. And we commonly refer to this, you're kind of creating your own human laboratory. We have made sure that you will be able to meet with people who are different, and we think that's a strength. So what are we doing in the first year? As you may notice, some of these functional areas already pop up. So for instance, you see accounting, you see organizational behavior, you see marketing management. Actually, we just started with a new program, so it has changed. So we're now having students in the first year of the new program. You'll be the second generation if you're your final year, or the generation afterwards. We also have some more skills-oriented courses in which we practice, for instance, how to interview a manager. So right in your first year, you'll already be sent to a company to conduct an interview with a manager, to collect information. Finance, of course, economics, some supporting courses like mathematics, statistics. And as I said, it's also very important that you're able to connect these functional areas. And one of the courses in which we try to do this is the strategic business plan. I never wrote one myself in this school, but our students did, so I've asked one of our students to elaborate a little bit on what she did in the strategic business plan, what kind of company she went to, and what she learned from it. Can you join me on stage?
Yes.
And who are you?
Hi everyone, my name is Eve Tlau, and I'm currently a second year international business administration student. And today I'm here to tell you a little bit more about one of the first courses you will encounter as a first year student, which is the strategic business plan. But before we dive into that, let me tell you a little bit more about myself. I'm Dutch, so I'm one of the dominant nationalities. I come from a very small town inside the middle of the Netherlands, and when I decided that I wanted to study here, I actually needed to move, and it has been a very interesting, but also very learningful journey for me up till now. I've met many new people from all across the world, and one of the things I've actually learned a lot from is the strategic business plan. To tell you guys a little bit more about that, it's a pretty intense course. It actually has a duration of 6 months, so it takes place during your third and fourth block. Yes, this is a little bit more about the company I worked together with, the strategic business plan. The ultimate goal is that you write a strategic business plan for a real-life company. So that means that as a student, together in a group of four students, you will make an internal and an external analysis, you will conduct interviews with employees, and in the end, you will recommend a strategic change. So I always like to think of myself when we did this, that we were kind of acting like consultants for a company. And I wrote my strategic business plan for Maas Internal Logistics, which is, as the name already indicates, a logistics provider for businesses, and it has customers such as Coolblue or H&M. And during the process, they were very excited to work with us, and I was very excited to see how the things are going on in real life, because I remember when I was in your shoes sitting here, I thought, okay, who is going to bridge the gap between your theoretical knowledge and your practical knowledge? And the strategic business plan is one of the answers for this, because as a student already very early on in the process, you will see how all the theoretical concepts you have learned are applied into real life, and that's a very valuable lesson as a student to already learn. So to conclude, it's a really good opportunity that's offered by the university for you as a student to actually go out there, to put yourself out there, and see how things are actually working in the field. So that's a little bit more about that. I'm still here around. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them to me during the panel or to my fellow ambassador students, which are also outside at the stand.
May I ask you one thing right away?
Yeah, of course.
When you worked for the company, did they give you access also to more, let's say, sensitive information? Because in order to come up with a good plan, you need to know a little bit about their competitive position, I think, their financial situation. Did they open up to you?
Yeah, they opened up to me, but it's during the strategic business plan, because for companies, they can be quite hesitant to actually give you full access to it. So as a student, you will actually sign a contract, a confidentiality contract, which the university offers you. So you show the company that everything that happens and you read about will stay inside the project. So that's the confidentiality agreement you have for that. And that was really nice because then they gave us access to everything. Because especially nowadays with all the data information and especially with all the competitors, companies can be quite hesitant to open up, but this was one of the ways they opened up to us.
And after all, you're only a first-year student, with all respect. Did they take you seriously?
They did, actually, yeah. They're very, in the beginning, they thought, okay, what are they going to do? But in the end, you also give the company a final presentation when you wrote your whole plan. And they actually took us very serious. We had a meeting with them, and they actually really listened to one of our strategic changes we recommended. So that's really good, because then you see that you will, in the end, also add value for the company, and you will give something back to them.
Sounds good. Yeah. Thanks. At Erasmus University, we have a reputation of being businesslike, but also being rather strict. Actually, so far in the Netherlands, we're the only university requiring you to successfully pass your first year in 1 year. So you're supposed to pass all your courses in the first year. You're not alone on doing this. Actually, we've tried to set up the program in such a way that we kind of provoke you all the time to work. And sometimes we get a little bit of criticism from our students. You make us work all the time. Yes, that's what we do. That's what we intend to do. So we test you at regular intervals with bonus systems, with intermediate tests, etc., just to avoid the situation we have like now, because this is the classical lecture, so to say. So I'm active. You're passive, you're just listening. If we would do that for 10 or 13 weeks and would then provide you with an exam, that's a recipe for disaster. So that's what we normally not do in the courses. We make you work all the time, and that's your work. And we have a whole social network which is present for you, student advisors, counselors, program management, etc. So we create the conditions to be successful in the program with us. Now the second year. Again, you see these functional areas popping up. So, for instance, you see entrepreneurship, strategic management, where it comes together. There's also a big research project, because after all, we are a research university, so you should be familiar with conducting research. We do a business simulation, just playing a bit of law that you would need, contract law, etc. Technology management, that's a nice one to mention, because in this course, we make you work together with students who study sciences and engineering at the Technical University of Delft. And I can tell you, they're different. That's not the typical business student, and it's our experience that you learn a lot from each other. You learn how an engineer or science student thinks, and the tech students, they learn, they find out how a business student thinks. And you're together on one project, on a patent. Very helpful. Then, the nice thing of having successfully passed your first year is that a range of options opens up for you. You're welcome to apply as a teaching assistant, because you're allowed to have a paid job with us then. So some students choose to be a mentor, helping second-year student, helping first-year students. Some want to be an ambassador, like the people around here in the blue shirts, helping with open days, information sessions. Some want to be a teaching assistant for a course, because they're good in mathematics or OB. Others go for case competitions, in which are through our case society, you can be put in a team, and then you try to solve a business case within 24 hours, somewhere closed in a hotel, competing with business schools all over the world, sometimes in the Netherlands, sometimes abroad. You can also apply for honors program. So if you want to do more than just the program, you're welcome to choose one of the honors programs that is offered by Erasmus University, choosing a broad theme. And we also have our own one, which is on innovation entrepreneurship. That's really entrepreneurship oriented, as the word says. The cherry on the pie of this honors program is that it will even bring you to Silicon Valley to see how high tech goes there on the other side, on the other half of the world. So lots of options. And actually, that's also the moment to think ahead, because somewhere in the second year, you have to decide for yourself, what am I going to do in the third year? What am I going to do afterwards? And the beginning of the third year is flexible, so this is the moment to already start thinking, will I go on exchange to one of the partner schools of RSM, or will I conduct an internship, or will I do a minor, which is a set of electives? You need to think ahead, and that's important anyway. We have, as said, a nice list of partner schools. If you would check, let's say, the international or the local rankings, for instance, if you would go through the US World and News overview of the best business schools in the US, you will find many schools who make it to the top 30 in the US in our overview of partner schools. You see Wharton, you see Michigan, you see Virginia, you see Babson, a lot of big names. And the nice thing, they're very expensive, but when we send you on exchange, you only pay the fee, the home fee for RSM. Same time, there's increasing demand going east to Asia, mainland China is expanding all the time. The same has happened for Hong Kong, the same has happened for Singapore. So we try to provide you with as many places as we can. And there's a lot happening in Asia, you know. Still, good old Europe also has a solid and vast amount of reputed business schools. We try to partner with the best schools in the country. So you see the best school in Italy, which is Bocconi, in Switzerland, which is St. Gallen. A lot of good schools that we're able to send you to. And they will send their students to us. As said, the third year brings choice. Actually, the first and the second year of the program are rather fixed. It's a lot of compulsory courses you need to do to swallow it all, so to say. But the third year is yours. In the first half, you choose between either going on exchange to one of these partners that I just showed you, or do a minor. You can do it for a limited amount of credits, but you can also take a bigger one together with Delft and Leiden. And you're also welcome to conduct an internship, and we offer these at various lengths. You can do one for 10 weeks, you can also do one for 15 weeks, so that's pretty flexible. In the end, you're supposed to end up with around 30 credits towards the end of January, and if you're not exactly filling the space, you need to fill that with electives, so we have a lot of electives on offer. So that's the first half, that's really meant to broaden your horizon. Second half, follow your passion. We know certain students would like to kind of specialize already a little bit, look for a little bit of differentiation, and we have created 5 so-called tracks. And these tracks have been provided with nice names, but actually, as an explanation, I've indicated some of the functional areas that you might find in the tracks. So the first 2 ones are more quantitative, so with a slightly more analysis, a little bit more of mathematics and statistics in it. So the first one is on logistics, supply chain, business information, and business analytics, a booming field. Second one on finance and accounting. And then we have 3 more qualitatively oriented tracks. The third one is the one on marketing, where you also find human resource management. One on strategic management, international business will be prominent in the 4th track. And the 5th track is for the entrepreneurs and innovators. So in this way, you're able to follow your passion, so to say. And this might also a little bit pre-sorting for a possible master that you might like to do. It's not a requirement that you've taken a certain track, but it helps, because it will definitely help you qualifying for a chosen master. When you take a track, you're supposed to take all 3 courses, and you will also write your bachelor thesis on the topic. Then, after the bachelor, the choice is yours again. You're welcome to stay with us. What we see is that taking a gap year is getting increasingly popular. Around a large percentage of IBA students in the past year did a gap year before continuing with a master, either with us or at another good business school. You can also start working for a job, earning a salary, and this may also qualify you for an MBA, which is a Master's in Business Administration. That's a master for which you need relevant working experience. 3 to 4 years relevant experience in the business, then you can go to an MBA. Then, a question often asked. We offer 2 programs at Rotterdam School of Management, one in Dutch, bedrijfskunde, very Dutch word, and one in English, International Business Administration. The difference is not so much in the content that we teach. I mean, we have the same finance, the same mathematics, the same accounting, etc. That's not the main difference. There's a difference in size. There's also a difference in admissions. As IBA program, we've been very popular over the past years. So when StudyLink closed around 15th of January, normally we found around 2,500, even 3,000 applicants in StudyLink. That's a lot. It's one of the larger programs in the Netherlands. So we need to be selective on admission. That's what we do. So the intake, the final intake, is much smaller, around 540, 550. Bedrijfskunde has an open admission, so when you apply and you bring your secondary school diploma, you're in, which leads to a bigger program. They currently work with 1,000 first-year students. The obvious difference, of course, is the language. There's no difference in entry requirements. So you need the same kind of diplomas. But the climate is a bit different. And what we know from the IBA students, there is a certain vibe in this program. And we know because students who come to the IBA program from abroad made a very deliberate decision. They have compared us with many other schools in the UK, in the US, in China, the rest of Europe. And when they decide, okay, I'm decided, and they go for it. They work, they're ambitious, put a lot of effort in studies, go for high grades, they're performers, which leads to a little bit of an ambitious climate, as we say. And we see that some Dutch students say, that's not for me, I'm happy when I pass a course, but others say, moi, I like this vibe. And it's not nerdy to go for high grades and be ambitious in the program. There's also a little bit of difference in the climate, the vibe in the two programs. Then, admission application. Because I know I need to press a button. Only the sound is missing at this moment.
But there are only a fixed number of places.
Start over again.
So before you... So you want to study IBA at Rotterdam School of Management, Erasmus University. Of course you do. It's one of the most prestigious schools in the world of business. You're not the only one who wants to study here, but there are only a fixed number of places. So before you pack your bags and head to Rotterdam, there are a few things you have to check. Do you have the right diploma? Is your maths level sufficient? Is your English good enough? On the RSM website, you can find the requirements for many diplomas from around the world. If you meet our minimum requirements, there's a reasonable chance that you'll be admitted and we encourage you to apply. The first step in the application process is to register in StudyLink between the 1st of October and the 15th of January. Within 24 hours of registration in StudyLink, you will receive a link to our online application form. The second step is to fill in the form and submit your application before the 31st of January. Be sure to apply as early as possible. This will save you from a lot of stress and will ensure that you meet the deadlines. After you've applied, the selection process begins. So, how does the selection work? First of all, the RSM admissions office will check your education background to see if you qualify. Selection points are then awarded for your grades from the last completed year of secondary school and your motivation to study IBA. After all applications have been evaluated, applicants are ranked according to the awarded selection points. On the 15th of April, StudyLink will send you your rank number. Applicants with rank numbers 1 to 650 will be offered a place in the program. Applicants with rank numbers 651 and higher will be placed on a waiting list. When an applicant declines their offer of admission, it will be given to the next person on the waiting list. All of this might sound a bit scary, but it really isn't. Everything you need to know is on the RSM website. See if you meet our admission requirements, and if you do, apply. We hope to see you at RSM in September. First of all, the RSM admissions. So before you pack your bags and head to Rotterdam, there are a few things you have to check. Do you have the right...
And now I need to get back to the presentation again. Let's see if I manage to do so. Not really. Need some assistance, I think. How do I get back to the presentation? Yeah. Thanks. Well, actually, I hope most of the video was self-explanatory, but still, a few phrases. We are a numerous fixers program, so we have set a limited capacity on the program. We have to, otherwise we would simply kind of be flooded with so many students, and we want to run a decent program. So we have a limited number. And the most important thing to remember is that you should not miss the first application deadline, because that one on StudyLink that you saw, 15th of January, that's very important. It's in concrete. If you miss that deadline, it cannot be repaired. It's not in our own hands. It's organized nationally in the Netherlands. When you miss 15th of January, you're simply out of procedure. The rest will kind of go automatically, so you'll be informed about the next steps as soon as you've made the first steps. But the first step should not be missed. And we work with a two-step procedure. When you're in StudioLink, you'll immediately get a message from us, okay, thanks, and we will inform you that you need to make a second step, upload some information in our online application form, our system. But that kind of goes automatically. Just follow the instructions. So, a check. If you're from the Netherlands, you bring the normal Dutch VWO diploma. That's a diploma we know very well, of course. We also need to check if the level of mathematics is there. So when you did A, B, or D, you're fine. If you're a C, you're not math sufficient, as we call it. And you might be invited to take a mathematics exam. And your English should be at a decent level. There's oftentimes a question, is my English good enough to be successful in this IBA program? Let me tell you, almost all people working for the IBA program are talking English as a foreign language. We have very few native speakers. Of course, we have some Americans, some British, but most of us talk English as a foreign language. And our experience is you can do this as well. The background of many diplomas that we know will definitely prepare you sufficiently to be able to cope with the level of English that we require. Some cases you can make use of your secondary school diploma because English is automatically included, but most students will be invited to take a language test like TOEFL or IELTS. Two components in our selection procedure. Grades matter for us, and they have a heavy weight in the rankings. So the better your grades at secondary school, the more points you get, the higher you will end in the ranking. It starts at a 7 in the Dutch grading system or an international equivalent for many other diplomas. If you're exactly at that, well, you're just threshold. The better you do, the more points you get for us, and that is around 3/4 of the weight in the ranking we compose. The other one, 25, is on motivation and CV, and there you have a choice. You can make a choice between either uploading your CV, but that's a limited definition of a CV because actually we're only interested in your international dimension. So by default, most international students will choose to upload their CV because they already kind of earn points of having this international experience coming from abroad, etc. That already helps. At the same time, this would sound a little bit unfair to our Dutch students, because, well, if you are from Capelle aan de IJssel and you've never really been abroad apart from summer holidays in France with your parents, you might score 0 points on this. But actually, you're still welcome to show us that you did a lot of international things, but you can also try to convince us by providing us with a good motivation. And actually, what we try to find out, do you really fit into this program? Although you are Dutch, do you want to go international? What is your reason to apply for this English-taught IBA program and not for the Dutch-taught bedrijfskunde program? Are you really interested in meeting people from different backgrounds? And not only at the beginning when everything is fun, but also when you need to work on projects, in workshops, etc., and when things are not that easy. And are you willing to consider to go abroad during your studies? Probably even consider going abroad for a job, make an international career. Is that where your serious interest is? And if you're able to provide us with a convincing story on this, we might even, no even, we will definitely give a highly motivated, a very Dutch student a place in the program. So there's equal chances, either a very international CV or a very solid motivation, and the choice is yours. As said, some examples. In a CV, it could help when you've already extensively traveled, when you gained international experience, when you've participated in projects, etc. You can also make statements with things like, well, in the VWO, you have the option to write your profielwerkstuk. So did you choose to write it in a business topic or an international topic? If you do the IB, you're required to write an extended essay, same story, what it is about. Is it relevant for international study in business? And at the same time, motivation, this can really help you. And it's worth thinking it over, because the better your story is, the more points you get, the higher your chances to get in. Ranking, we create a couple of tiers, as we called it, layers in the ranking. Actually, the only important tier for us is tier one, because so far we have only admitted students who were placed in tier one, and these are the students simply meeting all of our requirements. So the right secondary school diploma, the right level and grade for mathematics, the right level and grade for English, and all of the rest application also okay. As soon as you have a risk of not being in the first tier, it will be difficult to get in. So if you're mathematics is not that good, or if your English grade is too low, etc., it will be difficult. So try to make sure that you end up in the first year. That will improve your chances to be admitted. And so far, we have disappointed few people who were in this first year. Still, we could not let them all in, but a large majority who are qualified are in. We've already started. We already see the first applications coming in for next September. It's going fast again. So we're now collecting all this information. Then we run towards the deadline in January. Then an important moment. Around 14th of April, we need to upload our ranking to StudieLink, and already the next day, StudieLink will inform you about your ranking number. And as you saw on the video, if you are 650 or below, you're in. If you're above, you're not in, but I should say you're not yet in. Because actually, in the past, we saw that this international market, as we say, is so volatile. So many students have so many options, especially if they come from abroad. We see a lot of not accepting places, a lot of cancelling places, a lot of making different choices. Most people apply to more than one numerous fixes program, which is allowed in the Netherlands. So we see these numbers on the ranking list rapidly shifting. And the last year, I think we even gave an offer out to people having ranking numbers around 900. So don't be desperate if your first number is not exactly within 650. In the end, we also need your formal diploma, otherwise we can formally not let you in. Tips, apply on time, that's welcome, so we can also start working on time. Check the website, there's a lot of information. For instance, if you have a diploma of which you're not sure, do I qualify or not? For instance, if you have the Latvian diploma, the Spanish diploma, etc., it's described in detail on the website, on the admissions pages. You can exactly see what kind of scores you would need, what kind of courses you would need to have. That's all there. So the website is a rich source of information, also with regard to all the steps you need to make. Important, because we saw that in the past. Some people thought, I'm number 700, I'm not in. I cancel my application at StudieLink, only to find out later, I would have been in. My warning, if you cancel in StudieLink, there's no way back. So they will not re-accept you. So think it over before you cancel. The other way around, if you're sure IBA is not for me, at least not for the next year, then please cancel your place, because otherwise we will not be able to offer your place to someone else. Some practical things. Our normal tuition fee would be above 9,000 euros. However, if you are Dutch nationality or the nationality of one of the other countries of the European Economic Association, you pay a subsidized fee, which means that the taxpayer pays most for you, and the remainder of the fee, around 2,000 euros and a bit, is for you. If you're non-European, you can apply for scholarships, and they're merit-based, so on past performance, if you did very good at school, if you end up with a higher ranking number with us, you might be more eligible to find yourself for a scholarship. Visa, a necessity also for non-European people, will guide you through, so don't start it yourself. There's lots of information, and we make the first steps just to smoothen the procedure. Housing, start on time. We're not Amsterdam or Utrecht, but still, there's a lot of pressure on the market for living, for housing in Rotterdam. Our experience is, if you start on time, you're very well able to do it. If you just wait until July or August, then you will be having a tough job. We have on-campus dorms. You can stay on campus if you like, two, three buildings. We're still expanding. If you apply on time, you stand a pretty good chance to get in. You can stay there for 1 year, but actually in this year you will have found out that there are other places to live in Rotterdam and which are more affordable, because living on campus comes at a price, around 500-600 can be. Fully furnished, everything is there. But it's also possible to live as a student in Rotterdam for 300 or 400 per month, so it's worth checking it during your first year. Then, I could talk for hours, which I'm not going to do. You're most welcome to talk to our students, either real life, because, well, they're here, they're all around, but you could also do it online. And the nice thing about the IBA program is that, regardless your background, you might be able to find a student currently in the program that is like you. Because, well, simply because he's a boy, or he is Dutch, or German, or Latvian, or whatsoever, or he or she did the International Baccalaureate, or the French Baccalaureate, etc., which will help you. Because if you're curious, well, I'm French, the math that I did for the BAC at the AS Gestion, etc., will it be sufficient to survive? We have many French students who can tell you how it works, and if you're able to cope with the level or not. So take your chance with the UniBuddy program. That's a rich source of information. We also compiled information for parents. I see a lot of parents. So if you're interested to learn more about the reputation of RSM, how the fees work, chances of labor market, housing, etc., you're most welcome to check with us on the parents' website of IBA. Then, student perspective. That's not for me to tell you something about. We'd better ask a student. So we have one again. So, can you shortly introduce yourself and tell us if there's life besides IBA?
Yeah, definitely. Sorry. Hi everyone, my name is Chaitanya Mehta. I am a second year IBA student, and I'm going to tell you about the extracurricular activities you can do in addition to your studies. So when I started studying IBA, I realized there were a lot of associations and organizations a student can join in order to pursue their interests and develop new ones. So today I'm going to take you through a couple of associations that are there in the university, as well as a couple of them of which I am a part of. To start off with, there is STAR. So STAR is the main study association for the Rotterdam School of Management. It has about 60 to 70 committees that organize different events. They have workshops, they call guest lecturers, they have introductory days, and they have study trips. It's a good mix of fun activities as well as career-oriented services. They have management weeks as well as recruitment days. So you get the opportunity to have fun, meet new people, as well as develop yourself professionally. Moving on, there's SR. SR stands for Student Representation. Every module in IBA has a student representative, and the role of the student representative is to be a link between the students and the professor. So if the students want to say something to the professor, it's done through the SRs, and the opposite's true as well. If the professors want to say something to the students, it's via the SR. I want to emphasize that no matter how specific your interest is, there is something for everyone. So if you're interested in learning about culture, Chinese culture, there's a Chinese Student Association. If you want to know more about investment finance, there's the BERS Investment Society. And if you want to learn more about data science management and programming, there's the Turing Association for Students. Moving on, there's also Erasmus Sport. This is the collective for all sporting associations in the university. There's a sports center on campus, and it offers a lot of different sporting associations, including football, badminton, squash, boxing, you name it, it's there. I'm a part of the badminton association. I'm somewhere in this picture, you can't really see me. But yeah, I play badminton for the university. And I'm also part of ISEC. So ISEC is an association which tries to develop leadership qualities by emphasizing the sustainable development goals. The committee that I'm part of is responsible for sending students on exchange on projects to emphasize these sustainable development goals. So whether it's about poverty, education, water, or anything to do with sustainability, we have many projects that we send students on to emphasize the SDGs. So that's all I have to say about today. I will recommend you to join an association for a couple of reasons. Firstly, it's a great way to apply your knowledge that you've learned in class to the outside. It's also a great way to develop new interests and develop new abilities because you're going to be doing so many things in an association. Also, it's a great way to meet new people and make new friends. You get to know people outside your program, and you get to go for several social activities as well as events where you can just meet people, get their perspectives on things, and make new friends. So, yeah, that's all I have to say about the extracurriculars. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them to me at the stand on the first floor. I will be a part of the student panel that's happening at 11 o'clock, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask me. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Well, I think there's little time left for questions, but as said, we have a session with a student panel immediately afterwards, so you're welcome to ask all the questions that you still might have. It was a lot of information, but I hope it helps you by making correct decisions. Thank you for being here and for your attention.